Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Frame Rate is brought to you by Hover.com. Hover is domain name registration and management that's simple. For Hover's transfer concierge service free for our audience, go to Hover.com/frame. And by Netflix. Watch thousands of TV episodes and movies streamed to your PC, Mac, or TV instantly. Plus, get DVDs by mail in about a business day. For your free 30-day trial, go to Netflix.com/TWiT.
You look terrible.
Yeah, well, look at you.
Never mind that. Who's that guy?
And that's it.
Pretty much the whole movie. On the other hand, this is Frame Rate. Welcome to Frame Rate, episode 24. I'm Tom Merritt.
I'm Brian Brushwood.
You know, a while ago, it seemed like our numbers were artificially high. Like, oh my gosh, can't believe we're doing the show this long. Now I look at, am I really only 24?
Like we've been. Well, keep in mind also, we were like self-inflating our numbers because we would count all the betas and the alphas and the release candidates. And then, you know, we had been doing it for a while. But now, like, I think we're coming up on a year-ish of practicing, at least, since we got started.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Are you right? That's crazy. Okay, hold on.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's what it looks like when Tom Merritt has his mind blown.
June 29th, 2010 was episode 0.3, the first time we actually ever made a rundown. That means we had two episodes before that. So, yeah.
And those were just the release candidates.
In fact,
I think it was when I was there in studio and we were doing NSFW episode Melissa's Will Be Done, and we had Dr. Kiki on.
And she ran the board.
First ever alpha of the whole thing.
That's right.
So over a year now. Check that out.
Well, not quite. We're not in June yet. It's May.
Right. That's why I don't know my months at all. And I thought June was February because I'm not so bright. But you know.
Hold up your left hand. Okay. Hey, it's nice to see you, Brian.
It is great to see you, Tomas Merritt. What are we up to?
Well, we have a packed show full of news and big stories.
This just in, the big story.
Big story today, as we record this Frame Rate, it's Google I.O. Day. Google I.O. is their developers conference, and a couple of frame rateable stories here. Movie rentals hit the Android market, and Google TV is getting apps.
Yeah, this is
amazing. Not maps, apps.
This is amazing to me because I actually looked at the document. I'm like, where did these stories come from? Like, when you say developing now, you mean right now. So I guess, did you go to Google I.O.? What can you tell me about these?
No, I didn't go to it. I watched the stream and did the coverage here at the cottage like we do, sort of Mystery Science Theater style. And so what's going on? YouTube added movie rentals, added like 3,000 titles this week from a bunch of different movie houses. And now you're able to rent them from the Android marketplace as well and watch them either in your browser or possibly on an Android device, any Android 2.2 device or older. And eventually, you're going to be able to watch this stuff on your Google TV as well.
So what does this mean as far as how much penetration does this add?
Whoa, family show.
Okay, see, and I almost didn't use that word, but I thought it's a perfectly legitimate use of the word. In fact, it's the only legitimate use of the word. What does this mean as far as, is this in any way, like, is this 20% more than they've already seen so far? Is this half again as much? What does this offer as far as bringing the cord-cutting experience to the masses?
I don't know that this is going to bring the cord-cutting experience to the masses. The movie rentals, it's interesting. It's 30 days to watch the movie, 24 hours to complete it once you start watching it, which I hate. And rentals start at $1.99, but most of them are around $3 or $4. Market.android.com is the place to go, but you can rent the movies on your laptop, on your PC or your Mac. And when I say PC, I mean Windows. Your Windows machine or your OS X machine. Doesn't work in Linux, but it can work in Linux if that Linux is Android and it's running on a phone or a tablet.
That's crazy. Wow. Well, I'm trying to figure out. So did they say how many titles were at launch? You might have said that and I didn't hear it.
They added 3,000 titles. I don't know how many titles total are in the Android marketplace, but it's essentially the same store as the one you get if you go to youtube.com/movies. But just go to market.android.com, click on the movie rental tab, and you will be able to see all the stuff that is available there. I think the bigger news here, though, is that Android 3.1, which will be rolling out within the next couple of weeks to different devices, is going to come to Google TV this summer, and with it, the Android marketplace. So, yeah, it's nice that it's going to get 3.1 software and updates and the ability to do some cool facial recognition stuff eventually, but what is coming this summer to Google TV is apps. You're going to get an app store for Google TV. I think that makes that box totally different in worth. And we're going to get new Google TV devices, whether it's TVs or boxes, coming from Sony, Vizio, Samsung, and Logitech.
So I'm somebody who lives inside the iTunes ecosystem. Not that that's where I would choose to go, but I use an iPhone and my iPad. And so as a result, for convenience sake, I often buy stuff on the iTunes store. And when they started selling movies, when they started renting movies, that meant something to me because I had a relationship where I was buying music and getting podcasts through iTunes. And this is coming from somebody who's never used the Android marketplace. Is this a big deal from where you're sitting, or is this kind of like, is this going to be something that people discover? Like they're just, you know, going through their phone, like, oh, hey, I guess movies now.
I think if you're on Android, this might be a middling deal. You know, it's sort of, you don't have that iTunes ecosystem on Android yet. So Google announced a music locker so that you can store all of your music in the cloud and access it on all your Android devices. And you also have TV rentals available from the Android marketplace to rent and even watch offline. You can pin an Android movie rental. So yeah, if you don't have an Android device, this isn't a big deal for you, right? You're not necessarily going to be running to your PC to watch these Android devices, but if you or watch these Android movies. But if you have an Android device and you've been saying, gosh, I really wish I could load some movies on this tablet to take on the plane with me, and I can't buy iTunes movies because they don't work on my Android tablet, well, now you've got a store where you can go and download some movies. And, you know, they've got Inception and The King's Speech and Harry Potter, The Deathly Hallows Part 1, and they've got big titles.
Well, and so I guess that's the kind of that Netflix problem where it's like, I'm sure there's a Netflix app out for the Android and you could watch it, you know, everything in the Netflix streaming category, but you can't do it on the plane. You can't do it when you're cut off from the rest of the world. Right?
Also, it's only for the United States. So if you're not a citizen of the United States of America,
all the time, if we can, as a time saving measure, just say for the record, for everyone who likes to send us an email to frameRateShow@gmail.com, we're aware that certain services aren't available in other countries. And we're aware it totally sucks.
But you seem to not react at all to apps on Google TV. Does this not excite you?
I don't do anything with my TV. I do one thing with my TV, and that is watch things. If I want to play games, I will use a game console. If I want to get something useful done, I will use my PC. If I want to, you know, goof around, I'll use my iPad.
Yeah, to but me, like, apps mean more things to watch, not just games. I mean, it does mean games too, but
give me a scenario, paint a picture for me, pull a Steve Jobs and get me excited about this.
Brian, one of the problems with television is how do I find the things I want to watch? How do I schedule things? How do I find things? With Google TV's Android marketplace, you'll be able to watch Netflix. You'll be able to watch Hulu. You'll be able to take advantage of apps like SideReel that tell you what shows you're watching, what shows are available, which shows you've watched, and take you right to them straight from the app. No more wondering, am I caught up on this show? No more wondering, how many of the Smallvilles have I watched and which ones are left? You just look at the app, you click on it, you watch. It's that easy. I think you're going to love it.
You know, I was all prepared to be snarky and be like, oh, great, you're just grabbing my Xbox 360. But truthfully, I think it does sound pretty cool because what it's going to do is it allows a marketplace of people. I love my Xbox 360 experience. I love the video marketplace. I love the way that the Netflix app knows what I've watched and makes a suggestion, tells me what's new. It's like it's reading my mind all the time. And if there was an opportunity for more companies to be trying to outdo each other with those kinds of bells and whistles, then that could be very huge. But I guess that's another problem is I don't have a Google TV, and how good is the hardware on the Google TV? Because that's the problem. When I think of apps, I think of video players trying to play games or do some, you know, hitting the hard limit of what their processor capability can do. And so, and maybe that's just a made up issue in my mind.
Google TV, the Logitech review box that I own is a decent piece of hardware. It had some issues with HDMI pass-through, but that is the only technical issue it ever had. And that seems to have been fixed by a firmware upgrade. So it's a decent piece of hardware. I've never had any issue with the native apps that are on it. It already has Netflix on Google TV. There's an NBA app, a CNBC app, and a couple of HBO Go app on there. Those all work great. They deliver good HD streaming. I haven't stressed it because there's no game apps on it. So I don't know how well it would do if there was a Need for Speed app or something like that. But I, like you, don't think that's the killer thing here. I think it's interesting. You can put some games on there and play them. That's nice. But it's not set up for that. You get a keyboard. And so I could play some Angry Birds, check my Twitter. That's interesting to me. Those are nice little sidelines. The killer app is, can I use this to watch everything? If apps allow me, you know, to consolidate all these different sources in one place, that's what I'm looking for.
And I guess that's actually a really good point, because having apps allows a lot of people who might be nervous about having their content be available for, in, you know, for video on demand, it allows them to create their own ecosystem. It makes HBO Go its own little clubhouse inside your Logitech Google TV. And I can see the benefit of that down the road as far as offering, getting more people into the clubhouse.
I actually used my Google TV the other day to watch Game of Thrones, because the DVRs that I have every once in a while don't communicate with each other, and it was recorded on the DVR in the other room. So instead of getting up and going into the other room to watch it, or getting up and like unplugging the DVRs and trying to get them to talk to each other, I was like, you know what? I don't have to get up. Switched over to Google TV, launched HBO Go, was watching Game of Thrones, looked great.
So I guess the limitation I'm thinking of in terms of apps on Google TV devices, and again, this is not fair at all. I'm totally making this up. This is my perception. But when I perceive the Xbox 360 playing a video, this thing's got a ton of horsepower and is just barely using its brain to play some video for me. So I perceive that it's got way more overhead that can be filled up with other extras. Whereas I picture Google TV, I picture them making a box whose stated intention is to, I don't know, play video. And so maybe it's got, 10%, 20% overhead? So when I hear the idea of throwing apps on there as well, it just makes me suspicious. You know, I don't know how well that's going to go.
Yeah, when you have your 10-year-old device, the Xbox 360, playing video, you know, that you're right. That's a whole different thing than your less than a year old piece of hardware, the Logitech review.
But this is a piece of hardware that is designed to do a very small task. Okay, so it's like I'm not going to use a toaster to heat my house, even though it's the same fundamental principle, and even though my toaster is so much newer than my 10-year-old furnace. It doesn't matter. And likewise, keep in mind, you're the one who is defending having all this stuff built into televisions, which are on a 10 to 15 year buy cycle. BUY cycle. It's not riding a bike.
But wow, a 10 year bicycle.
It's a very impressive bicycle. It'll stick around for a long time. All right.
I believe it's the Atom processor in the Logitech review. It's a 1.2 gigahertz processor. So it's decent. You know, it's as good as a tablet, if not better.
Good. We'll see. I mean, we'll see. It's just...
It's a 1.2 gigahertz Intel Atom processor. What's the processor in the Xbox 360 these days?
I don't know, but it's so old. And we've talked, this isn't really a frame rate thing, but we talked about it last year at E3.
It's a Xenon.
I am so shocked that essentially for the first time in my lifetime, all the major players are just sitting out a development cycle. This would have been the year that you would have seen an Xbox 480 or whatever, but instead everybody made toys with cameras on it. And I have suspected and long suggested that the next 2 years will be very good for PC gaming as a result, as all of a sudden these consoles look older and older and older. Although I may need to amend that, because now we're seeing tablets really come in as a dominant force in gaming, like with the iPad 2.
Yeah, it's a Xenon processor in the Xbox 360.
I believe the graphics card is now five generations behind what you can get for a desktop. I mean, it's really crazy.
It does have three symmetrical cores that are 3.2 gigahertz, so that's pretty nice. But yeah, the graphics processor is behind all that. It is apples and oranges, though, right? You know, we're not. Your point is actually still. I'm being nitpicky. Your point is well made, which is the Logitech Review is meant to be sort of an ultra tablet that can do things versus an Xbox 360, which is meant to be a game machine.
Right.
You know, so we'll see. I mean, I think a game console still is the leader in being your box for everything as they start to add more and more things, right? As Microsoft says, we got Hulu Plus now. We've got Netflix, because it can do so much. But a lot of people don't want to do that. A lot of people have the reverse of what you're saying, and like, I don't need to buy something that plays games. I don't, you know, I just want something that streams the videos. And the apps for me are not so much about adding horsepower of gaming or other things to it, but just adding lots of different innovative ways to view video.
Well, and there's two things that consoles have as an advantage, and because essentially you're right, consoles are not going to be going up against stuff like the Google TV because they're able to do apps as well. Number one, most 30-somethings have always had a console hooked up to their television show, or at least if not most, then certainly a lot of them. So as gamers get older, it becomes less weird to them to have a video game console in the living room. Same thing, the older people, I find, you know, they, for some reason, you know, I want something with a remote control. I don't want a crazy gizmo thing. But I think we're seeing a lot of that reverse. We're losing a lot of that stigma as well, especially with the campaigns that the PlayStation's doing with the, you know, every single ad, it makes it very clear that this is not just a gaming device. It's also your Blu-ray player and your way to watch Netflix on demand, all these different services.
This is not just a gaming device. In fact, it's not really even an online gaming device, at least not this week. Anyway, maybe we should move on to another big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
Interesting article in Wired this week. As 3D hits the tipping point, filmmakers face polarizing decisions. This is as the 3D movie becomes the norm versus the exception. Filmmakers are feeling more and more pressured to force their movies into 3D conversion.
The biggest line that popped out of me in this whole article is the very first one. It says, the eye-popping spawn of Avatar reached critical mass this month when, for the first time, 3D openings will outnumber wide-release 2D movies at the box office. Now, I don't know if that's intentionally ambiguous, saying that movies that are available in 3D outnumber releases that are only available in 2D, or if it's saying, I have a hard time believing that Thor showed up in more 3D theaters than in 2D theaters when it came out.
It did in my neighborhood.
Really?
When we went to see Thor, I said, you know, I'm like, well, you know, we're at the mall, and it's showing at 2 o'clock in 3D, and Eileen's like, do we really have to see it in 3D? I'm like, well, there's only 4 showings of 2D, and there's like 26 showings for 3D. She's like,
wow.
All right, well, fine. So it was far and away available at more times in 3D than 2D. They only had it in one theater with 4 showtimes, where they had it in like 4 or 5 theaters in 3D.
How do you decide what movies you do and don't want to see in 3D? Like, some of them are slam dunk. Like, I think the experience of Avatar, if you only saw it in 2D, I think you saw a very familiar story with some nice colorful visuals. But if you saw it 3D, you got a fundamentally different experience. I don't know that I'd feel that way about Thor. I did about, I loved seeing How to Train Your Dragon in 3D. I thought that was very worth it for the immersive experience. But what's your personal way of deciding whether or not you want to see it in 3D?
Well, in the past, it wasn't even a decision. If it was available in 3D, I saw it in 3D because it, you know, not that many things were in 3D, and I wanted to experience in 3D and see what it was like. these days, it's starting to become a decision. I saw the Pirates of the Caribbean trailer before Thor, and that looked awful. The trailer was in 3D. Everything was flat, but had depth, right? So it looked like little cardboard cutouts of, you know, of Jack Sparrow and Penelope Cruz, you know, were like paper puppets. And then there was a background, you know, distantly behind them. There was no roundness to anything.
What were those things called that had the stereoscopic and you clicked it, the wheel forward, like color filmations or what were those things? You know what I'm talking about? You've got the ice cream.
ViewMaster. Thank you, Jammer B.
ViewMaster. Okay.
I actually have ViewMaster in my house.
No way.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's what it looks like, right? So it's like you got these 2D elements placed with just a depth of field, and that's it, right?
But it looks like we're going to be having less and less choice because you can shoot in 2D and convert to 3D rather cost efficiently. And Chris Cookson, president of Sony Pictures Technologies, says 2D to 3D conversion has the potential to far exceed what you can do with native capture because you have so much control.
Yeah,
sounds like the studios are all about this.
Yeah, we had talked about this a while ago. A friend of mine from high school now works over at Warner Brothers and was saying that even movies that from the ground up, like decided on day one, this is going to be a 3D movie. We're going to shoot it as a 3D movie. We want it to be a huge experience. They're finding that the stereoscopic cameras are a big enough pain in the butt and they end up not using so much of the capability of it that they're like, we'll just shoot it in 2D and fix it in post.
But that cardboard cutout syndrome that you get when you convert is what happened with Pirates of the Caribbean. So you have to be careful. Apparently, you have to put a lot of human touch to it. Well, I thought the 3D in Thor was mostly good. I didn't have cardboard cutout syndrome that much. But apparently, Kenneth Branagh, the director, took a lot of care in where to use 3D and where not.
Well, and that was one of the interesting ideas that I saw was the idea that for a close-up shot of somebody's eyes or their face, where it would be distracting to have the nose poking way out of the screen, they actually kind of flatten it. And like, did you notice those moments when you're like, oh, now it's flat, now it's not?
Not really. No, I actually forgot that I watched the film in 3D until I was talking to Sarah Lane earlier today, and she mentioned that, you know, she asked, did you see it in 3D? I'm like, oh, yeah, I did see it in 3D. Which I find that a sign of a good 3D movie is that I don't notice it. I just kind of get lost in the world, and that's good.
Yeah. So what? I guess since we're talking about Thor, we'll kind of jump ahead here. Can you give us your nickel review of the show?
My nickel review of the show, I posted on Twitter, which is it's a comic book movie, so it's thin in places, but I'm okay with that because it's a comic book movie. Didn't hate it.
So didn't hate it.
That's what they'll put up on the movie poster, which maybe that's damning it too much with faint praise. But I thought it was good. We got out of the theater and Eileen's like, that was good. I'm like, yeah, that was good. And what's funny is at that point, it seemed like our reviews were about the same. Right. And then as we talk, she's like, yeah, I really like this and I really like that. And I was like, yeah, that was all right. You know, I was a little bugged by the fact that, you know, they were able to like change the guy's identity when they didn't even have their computers because they'd all been stolen. But, you know, whatever. She's like, oh, well, that didn't bother me. I thought this was amazing. I'm like, yeah, that was pretty nice. And it turned out she was like, I really liked it. And mine was like, it was okay.
You know, of the two big movies this year, obviously we got a ton of comic book movies, but the two that I thought had the biggest problems to begin with were Thor and Captain America, just because both of those are so over the top, especially if you read the comic book. You know, I could pick, you know, I was accustomed to the images of the Incredible Hulk, seeing the TV show as a kid, and so I could wrap my mind around that. Iron Man pulled off, you know, it was very realistic. You know, I wrap my mind around this billionaire who's got some, you know, who's got toys, but the idea of this Norse god, you know, clowning around.
Whoa, spoiler alert.
Okay.
Yeah, that's blue, if anything. That's infrared, is so how low on the scale it is.
I didn't know Thor was a Norse god. I was keeping myself purely virginal to the storyline.
But the important thing is, to me, the question is did it pull off like not being incredibly hokey, you know, the way that the Fantastic Four movie maybe had trouble doing?
I felt like probably 87% of the time it pulled it off.
Okay.
There were a few times, and I think it was pulled through by direction talent, script talent, and acting talent. But for some reason, every once in a while it slipped. And I that might have been direction. That might have been storytelling. But the rest of the time, everything was so strong that I overlooked those parts and it didn't ruin it for me.
Well, and we've talked about this before, and I'm glad to say it's not the viewer's fault if you fall into that moment. It is the director's fault because you can pull it off. And the example I always use is I watch Men in Black, and I never once get annoyed at the physics because there's something about the way the storytelling happens that it's like, I just don't care. I'm having too much fun.
Yeah.
And if they're able to do that with Thor, even for 87% of the time, that's fantastic, and I'm super impressed.
You know what? I'm gonna blame the script. Okay. Because I feel like the direction was solid and the acting was great. I felt like Natalie Portman really carried it and did a great job. And there were lines that she had to say that just no one could have made good.
With a straight face.
Yeah, and that's where it weakened for me because the contrast was so apparent between her ability and the line that she was given to deliver. And again, I don't want to overstate that because it didn't happen that often. It was only really a handful of times. Count them on one hand.
I tell you what, since we're already talking about Thor, what do you say we jump all the way into Film Found? And to get started on Film Found, do you remember last year?
Actually,
episode?
Wait, hold on. Before we get into Film Found,
yes.
Do you want to register the domain name? Blue spoiler alert is not appropriate for Thor.com.
Yes, as long as I could also add dash plus Tom Merritt's a jerk.
Yeah, well, you could get TomMerrittsAJerk.com at the same time.
You know what? Let's see, where do I go?
Oh, wait, you already had TomMerrittsAJerk.com, but you don't have it registered at our sponsor, Hover.com.
No, so you're going to need TomMerrittsAJerk.com, but I will register it right now.
You're going Hover.com. To need the concierge service. To transfer it from your own old registrar. Just play along. Just play along like you have it.
Gotcha. Yes, because I've got Photoshops of what a jerk you are and little animations, like animated GIFs on there. Like, you know, I do the walking man who walks over and he pees on your name.
It says
Tom Merritt at the bottom.
Yeah.
I've got it's an old GeoCities page, but now that GeoCities is no more, I was able to back it up. But I don't know enough to get my awesome website over to the new TomMerrittsAJerk.com.
All right, fine. You know what? We don't need these tortured segues. We don't need to trick the people into using Hover. Hover is a sponsor of Framerate. And if you register domain names, Hover is the place to register because it's perfectly simple. They don't try to sell you a ton of services. You put in the domain name, thomasajerk.com. It tells you it's available. You buy it. Done. And if you have a problem, if you are transferring from a registrar where you're tired of dealing with all of the crap and you're like, you know what, I just want to have it on Hover.com, you can call them Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m., no hold policy. You get a live person when you call, and as a TWIT audience member, you get free transfer concierge service. Hover offers TWIT audience members free domain name transfer no matter how many domain names you have. It's usually a $25 service. Just call Hover, give them your username and password, and they take it from there. Hover will get the authorization codes, deal with all the emails, let you know when your domain names are on Hover and working exactly as you want them to. Each domain name transfer is $10 per domain for the registration, but you don't have to pay for the concierge service because you're a TWIT audience member. So go to hover.com/frame and you just use the offer code frame to get Hover's free transfer concierge service or just to register domain names. And we thank them for their support of Framerate. Okay, now should we start Film Found?
Well, we got a face-off because normally we go to our very long Film Found intro, but we said we wanted something shorter with a bit more punch, and we had two people send in graphic assets. And so why don't we go through both? I'll let you pick which one you want to do first, Jammer B, and we'll go head-to-head for the ultimate Film Found.
Candidate number one, please. Okay, this is a local TV evening movie special from 1978.
Yeah, it was labeled as the Grindhouse version. And I think he was riffing on the beginning of the Call of the Dead, the Treyarch production that they did at the beginning.
Gotcha.
I like that one quite a bit, although I do think we could speed it up a little bit on the animation.
I think his typeface was a little too modern. That was the only thing that took me out of the Grindhouse world.
Yeah, maybe a little more, you know, film decayed on there. We should make the assets.
Background was killer, though. I love the background and the music. All right, candidate number two, what have you got for us in our Film Found transition?
Yeah,
All right, you know what I want? You know what I want? I want a mashup. I want the music and the gunshots and the typeface from candidate number two with the background of number one.
You know what? I'm sure we'll get something interesting as a result. But that one was labeled as the Blaxploitation is what it was labeled as. Going for like that 70s funk style.
Actually, I take the music from number one, too, with the gunshots and the typeface from number two.
Yes. Yes. Well, regardless, it's time for Film Fountain.
Yes. And U.S. DVD sales plummeted 20%.
Hey!
Good news for nobody.
Somebody?
Yeah, DVD sales plunged 20% in the U.S. in the first quarter of 2011. Hollywood studios blaming the timing of Easter and a glut of blockbuster releases last year for the decline. DVD and Blu-ray disc sales fell from $2.58 billion last year to just more than $2 billion in the first 3 months of this year.
Now, we also heard, I think just last week, we were talking about the story that in the theaters, the first quarter was slow for new release movies as well. So it wasn't just the DVD release. It seems like everybody was kind of down. Maybe it was Easter that just messed it up for everyone.
I don't know. How consumer spending on streaming and subscription services rose 33% to $695 million, though. So people were still willing to spend money on movies in one way.
Yes. Well, and the first thing I thought was, okay, well, was it enough to offset the damage? But apparently it's still down in general for total, including DVDs and online video on demand, apparently still down from the previous year, which I don't think this is an indication that we're not watching movies.
No. But, say the second quarter is already off to a strong start, up 20% in the first few weeks. They expect an array of impressive blockbuster theatrical releases later this year. To round out 2011, and they're not expecting it to be down for the entire year.
Yeah, well, I would imagine not, but still, it's like this is going to be part of the reason this story is getting the traction that it is because this is what we're going to expect to see more and more of. I mean, is there anybody who really doesn't think that we're definitely making a sea change away from DVDs, if not to Blu-ray, then on demand and in digital distribution?
Every head of DVD sales for every movie distributor and publisher believes that we will not see that.
Now we've said this. We talked about this last week. There's a dollar value to a certain amount of idiotic grandstanding in order to keep your shareholders happy. And I wonder how long and how loud they'll continue to say that. I think we're going to see a tapering down of these proclamations, and then suddenly, like, no, I didn't say that. I didn't. DVD. No, DVD means dumb video dumb. Didn't you know that? No, we never liked DVDs.
Bad news from AV Club. It looks like the Dark Tower production team has been put on hiatus, and Universal is reconsidering adapting the series for movie and television. It was an ambitious project to begin with, but now it looks like they're having second thoughts. Deadline reports that the pre-production staff have been asked to stop working. All plans for a September start date have been canceled. However, the studio officially still insists the project is a go.
I honestly can't decide how I feel about this because, number one, love the Dark Tower, love the epic sweeping narrative, love the story, want so bad to see it taken to a new medium, but I was nervous about it being Ron Howard. I was nervous about this mashup of PG-13, you know, PG movies and suitable for television primetime ways to tell the story. I'm hoping that this means that they're gonna that the project goes back into limbo and that there's enough heat around it that they can figure out the right way to tell the story. But if what little I understand about Hollywood is any indication, this is usually not a good sign for, you know, heat on a project when somebody puts it on a hiatus.
I think from reading this that the most likely scenario is Universal looked at how much the cost was going to be and decided, for maybe changed conditions or whatever reason, that they didn't want to pay all of this, but they also don't want to give up on it and are looking for a partner. They're looking for another studio to come in on it with them, maybe take over the television side or the movie side, one or the other. And if they can get another studio to help them out, that they will go ahead and do it. But they're cost shy right now, which is why they've asked people to stop working on it, because they don't want to spend any more money off it. But why they insist it's still a go, because they don't want to kill it.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I mean, maybe regardless of what happens, I'll tell you what, man, for years I've been watching all the speculation about all the different Dark Tower possibilities, and the one that made me the happiest, the one that I thought was the most right as far as being able to, I guess, spoiler alert, blue, I'm not going to give any specifics here, but the Dark Tower is filled with these sweeping visualizations, these larger than life images, and even characters that are larger than life, and that might even seem to be like a caricature of people you'd imagine. There's magical, there's an unusual creature that's in the show and apparently is going to be CG in the live action project. But of everything I heard, what I would have loved to have seen was an HBO miniseries, or I guess series, HBO series, one season per book, animated by Samurai Jack creator Genndy Tartakovsky, who did the Clone Wars, if you ever watched those animated cartoons, those short ones. That would have been amazing.
Yeah, I want to see it turned into good movies and television. I actually liked the idea of it being movies and television to carry on part of the story. If that television was Stars or AMC maybe or HBO, where they could tell the story appropriately. I was a little worried about the idea of it being on CBS or something like that. Not that I have anything against CBS.
Lost was on ABC, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that doesn't mean...
But you still, I mean, they still couldn't curse or, you know, show really, really disgusting violence.
Well, yeah, there's no shortage of cursing or showing really disgusting things. I mean, look, there are times that you are supposed to be seeing horrific visuals that scar you as you read the book.
And the characters. Spoiler. Yes.
Yeah, Biff.
Characters get scars.
And along the way, I just don't. None. In fact, now that I think about it, I'm full on like put this thing on pause or and figure out a better way to tell the story than with Ron Howard and on primetime television with computer generated animals.
For some reason, Ong Lee's name just popped into my head, but I think that's a bad idea. I don't know why that popped into my head.
Well, you don't think it's a bad idea because the original Hulk got a bad rap. I actually liked the original Hulk. The first movie.
The place that I got married was featured in the original Hulk.
No kidding. That's awesome.
It's a restaurant. It's not a restaurant, but they use it as a restaurant set.
I was about to say, you got married in a restaurant?
No, I got married in an old officers club on Treasure Island.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
All right. What do you think of this Time Warner, Warner Brother Home Entertainment Group buying Flixster, the movie discovery service, which also owns Rotten Tomatoes?
I understand why they'd want to do it. I question, is it ever a good thing when a provider of movies buys a way to discover movies?
I don't know that it's such a good idea, although there could be some good effects from it. They want to run Flixster as its own company still. They're not going to fold it into some department at Warner Brothers. And they really want to use it to learn about digital ownership and digital viewing. And so Flixster may be able to have some good effect on Warner Brothers. I'm not sure that it'll work the other way, though.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what they... I understand why they want to do it. If this really is their goal, if they're looking to... If they want a map of the digital video ecosystem, then you've done very well. You bought a GPS system with Flixster. You're going to get incredible amounts of data to mine. But I don't see why they needed to buy the company in order to do it. And I think there's a substantial appearance of impropriety. I mean, it certainly changes things when you're like, oh, you'll never guess what production showed up in your recommendations. Or, you know, and obviously Rotten Tomatoes as a review aggregator, for the most part, you know, they can't juke the stats on, you know, on the percentages of positive.
No,
and
I wouldn't worry about that. I think Warner Brothers has enough content sense not to mess with Rotten Tomatoes. I don't expect them to come in and start saying, well, you've got to wait your algorithm to be positive towards Warner Brothers movies. But it's always going to make people wonder, right?
Well, exactly. And in total fairness, I understand. I am not accusing anything of impropriety. I don't think there will be any. But it just seems like you should be aware of the appearance of that kind of thing.
That's always what it is. It's always the appearance of impropriety, not the actual commitment of impropriety that's an issue. And you're not going to avoid that appearance when Warner Brothers owns Flixster and Rotten Tomatoes by extension. But,
and again, it's not, well, okay. Yeah, I mean, it's like... I don't know what it will change, and it doesn't sound like, of the reasons listed why they want to do this, They didn't say because we think we're going to make a crap ton of money on this purchase. You know, they gave answers about like, you know, well, we want to learn more about this digital space, that kind of thing.
Yeah, and that's why I say I think Warner Brothers could learn a lot about digital and what people want and what kind of portability options people want with movies and the idea of digital everywhere and owning a movie and being able to watch it on all your devices. I think Flixster can have a good effect on Warner Brothers. I don't see what Warner Brothers brings to Flixster that unless they get them some exclusive video clips or something, maybe some leverage with the other studios to get more access, but... Overall, I think Flixster and Rotten Tomatoes do a great job as it is. I'm not sure that they need a lot other than money. Maybe there's a money infusion.
Yeah, I'm sure that's what it is. They brought a giant fat paycheck to these guys who have been busting their humps for a decade now. Now, what is Flixster? What is the Flixster experience? I don't think I've ever used the service.
I use Flixster as an app on my phone. And essentially, it's the best movie ticket buying app that I've used. It's very clean, and it geolocates, so it just shows me the theaters that are around where I am. And then when I click into a movie, it gives me the Rotten Tomatoes rating for it right there. So I know like, oh, okay, this movie's getting good reviews. And then I'm able to buy tickets right from within it.
Man, they really will. You know what? The more I'm thinking about this, proprietary be damned, they're going to have amazing inside sauce as to what consumers respond to. They're going to be able to personally track for their own movies like, wow, 38% of our people decided within 10 minutes of the movie that they were going to buy the ticket. That's amazing. Or, you know, whatever other data that they can do. Or it's like, you know, people who went, you know, even people who go to Rotten Tomatoes and see a 20% positive review still end up buying the tickets. I mean, that's the information that would be a freaking goldmine.
Goldmine of data, absolutely. Netflix CEO Reed Hastings in the news interview with Peter Kafka swears he's not out to kill HBO. He says he and HBO compete like football and baseball. Of course, talking not only about the battle of words with Books from Warner Brothers over Netflix getting access to TV shows, but also talking about the idea of producing in-house television shows, which they have that one House of Cards TV series that they're going to produce backed by Netflix.
Yeah, it's interesting to see. Not so much a war of words. It's not like there's a war of words. It's the war of words they're not saying. Everybody, like Netflix, is very careful in this interview to downplay the importance and the relevance of what they're doing with House of Cards. And in fact, try to liken it to other projects. What did it say? Like Friday Night Lights was not going to be renewed by NBC, but they were doing so well on the video on demand. I think DirecTV was that they were able I don't know the full story, but they were alluding to another story where they either were going to finance it themselves or they were about to finance it themselves and it influenced NBC to keep going or something like that.
Yeah, I think DirecTV was going to produce it alone and NBC said, well, shoot, if it's worth that much, then, you know, we should keep doing it.
Right. Go ahead.
No, I that's all. I mean, I just think it's interesting how Netflix is handling all this attack instead of attacking back. They're saying, hey, no, we want to work with you guys, you know, I think that's been the brilliance of Reed Hastings all along, doing a service that could be seen as very contentious to the movie industry. He's been able to say, let's do it in a way you're comfortable with. I want to rent DVDs to the world. Let me do that in a way you're comfortable with. I want to stream movies to the world. Let me do that in a way that you're comfortable with. And this is his biggest challenge because it's being conducted in public, very publicly for the first time. And he's saying, hey, you know what, Time Warner? I just want to do this in a way you're comfortable with. I don't want to drive HBO out of business. That would hurt me. And Books from Time Warner has even backed up and said, kind of snottily, though, you know, sure, Netflix can have all our reruns. And Reed Hastings is like, good. That's what we want. Yeah. That's what we want to be.
This is, I'm going to term this the Weird Al defense, where it's just like, what? You're going to make like a real crappy version of my music and make a video making fun of my video? This is a terrible idea. And Weird Al's just like, hey, bro, the only reason I'm doing this is because everybody loves you. Nobody's going to confuse the two of us, but they think you're so great. They think me doing a funny version of it would be great. By the way, I'm going to write you a check. You know, it's like, I think Netflix is the Weird Al of this scenario.
Yeah. All right, before we get into the movie draft check-in, we got one more story that we should go to spoiler alert yellow for.
Oh, yes.
This is some rumors about the plot for the Avengers movie. Now
we should say this. We're putting up spoiler alert yellow, but for some reason, and it even says in the headline of this, this is from comicbookmovie.com, says rumor, more potential spoilers for the Avengers reveal. Now, normally, I'm very spoiler averse, especially for movies that I intend to like. And this thing has everything going for it. It's, you know, it's got, what's his name, who I love so much? Joss Whedon on there, right?
Yes.
Yeah, and so, but for some reason, when it's a translation of a book or a comic book, or if it's a story I'm already familiar with, man, I just don't care about spoilers at all because I'm already familiar with the story, right?
Right. Well, there's two things, right? One is it's about what elements of the story that is already known will exist in the movie, and these are rumors. We don't know for sure that this is how the movie is going to go. So it's not even really a spoiler if it doesn't end up being true.
Yeah, and that's the other thing. It's I love rampant speculation and ideas, and that's, you know, that's kind of what Ain't It Cool News has been king of, is the rampant speculation. And I like knowing that it is just speculation and rumor, and that it might go nowhere. Because whereas a spoiler, a hard spoiler that I know for a fact this will happen, I just spend the whole movie, I'm just like, is this the part where Spock dies? No, is this the part where Spock dies? Okay.
Spoiled. Glad we had the spoiler alert up. Okay.
Do you know that in Wrath of Khan, that's why they had Spock get killed at the beginning of the movie when they're doing the Kobayashi Maru simulation and he dies? Like, the rumor had gotten out that Spock dies in the movie. So they
planted a, that's all people were talking about.
Exactly. So, like, if you heard that rumor, you're like, Spock died. And then they even get up, they're like, I thought you were dead. We're like, well, I'm not dead anymore. It turns out the rumors of my death were exaggerated. And so that you put it to bed. Yeah.
I didn't realize that. That's pretty nifty.
Yeah.
All right. First spoiler, the script is epic.
Spoiler alert. Ultraviolence.
That's the kind of stuff we're talking about. Also, great fights with lots of spaceships.
Oh, no. Yep. Ruined. Why do I even bother going?
All right, some things that
are... I'm going to be like, is this where the spaceships come in? This is where the spaceships are going to come in, isn't it?
That's totally ruined for me. Okay, here's where it gets spoilery from the actual story. Skrull's homeworld had been destroyed, just like in the comics. S.H.I.E.L.D. found the cube. Fury knew it was only a matter of time before they would come back. And the Skrulls have been to Earth before. They just thought the cube was no longer on Earth.
See, this is the other thing. The only people, this is the weird thing. The only people to whom these would be spoilers are people who know WTF a Skrull is, which means you've already been familiar with the story, which means you've already had everything spoiled that's going to be spoiled.
Yeah. So there you go. I mean, it's basically saying some important elements of the Avengers backstory are going to be in the Avengers movie.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert. All right, let's check in on the I keep getting this pop-up whenever I go to that link from comicbookmovie.com. That's annoying.
Is it popping up?
Don't go to comicbookmovie.com. You heard everything you need to know about the spoiler. Okay.
We have since we're going to talk about the NSFW movie draft, we actually have a little something, Jammer B.
Ooh, what is this? Wow. I feel like I should be in my tie again.
I know, right? That comes in from Zach Holder, a.k.a. DJ Z.
Nicely done.
Yeah, he said he's got, I don't know what he's doing, but he is sending me all these awesome spoofs of NSFW frame rate related stuff. I'm sure we'll pepper them throughout the episodes as they come up here. But man, this is a big, big week. Thor, I think.
71.1 million for Justin Robert Young.
And now
honestly, Houston. I was a little underwhelmed by that. I figured it was going to be 80-85. So I mean, it's not like it did poorly. Oh, you have 78 and you're in that one.
Here's what you should see is, by the way,
he's got 78 total. That's what it is.
Yeah, if you go to draft.nsfwshow.com, you can see these are all updated daily. And, of course, I think there's a Twitter feed that you can follow as well. If you go down to the bottom, it'll tell you who to follow. But a couple things that that are of note. Right now, this was a big one for me because I was out of it. I was screwed. All my movies had underperformed expectations. But then Fast Five came in above expectations with like $83 million last week.
And now it's total $142 million. So it had a great second week.
Right. Well, exactly. It's got enough staying power that I think it made $38 million over the weekend. So I'm hoping that Fast Five, by the time it runs out of steam, because right now it's got Thor to deal with. But like next week is Priest and Bridesmaids, which I'm not seeing a lot of competition from. But I think Fast Five stops making money once Pirates of the Caribbean on Stranger Tides comes out.
Let's put it this way. Fast Five in 2 weeks doubled your money.
Okay. Well,
you had four other movies.
That's more of a testament to how poorly all my four movies have done until now. But my big question was whether or not Thor was going to steal the thunder of Fast Five. Now, it did from a financial perspective because all of the IMAX and the 3D theaters, which make a lot more per ticket, they switched over to Thor this week. And so as a result, that's why you saw that massive drop off, even though the movie was still being seen a lot, but it jumped from $83 million down to $38 million. But I'm hoping that this thing continues to make, you know, a few million a day for the next 2 or 3 weeks. And then I got a chance. But I will say this. Thor was bought for $23 and made, you know, $70 million. What was the exact number over the weekend?
$71,126,000.
There you go, over the weekend. Whereas I got away with paying only $21 for Fast Five, and it made $83 million. So everyone's been calling me the April Fool for my movie picks. So there's at least one that was not dumb. So,
and I figured that would be your best one, for sure. And we'll see if it still ends up being the best buy. Right now, it's $6.7 million per dollar spent, per Brian Buck spent.
No, but I guarantee you that Sarah's going to have the best buy. She got, I forget what it was.
Harry Potter.
She got Harry Potter for ridiculous, for 30 bucks.
Yeah. Crazy. Sarah Lane enters the fray this weekend. Right now, it's been 5 Brian weeks, followed by 2 Justin weeks. And this week, Sarah Lane, double feature, Priest and Bridesmaids, both her movies coming to theaters this weekend.
And it should be pointed out that they're also in 2 different categories. And Bridesmaids, of course, the question is this going to be like the girl version of The Hangover? Is Bridesmaids going to take off? Because apparently it's got some talented comedians associated with it. I haven't really paid attention to any of the early reviews on it one way or the other. Priest is a 3D release, which means the 3D releases tend to make more money. But I don't know how big of a franchise Priest is. And to this day, I can't even tell you what that show's about.
Priest is about vampires.
Well, I knew that. It's something 3D and a guy who's a priest, I guess.
And vampires.
And kills vampires?
Well, there's vampires.
All right.
Oh, do you need to know anything else?
What you're saying is you will definitely be drug out there by Eileen to go see the movie.
It's quite possible, yes. She wants to see Bridesmaids, too. It's kind of a hard choice for her.
You could do a double feature.
We could. So Sarah Lane is going to fill in for me because I'm going to be out of town next week. And so she'll be in on Frame Rate with you next week to kind of review Priest and Bridesmaids and talk about how well it is. She also, according to Hollywood Stock Exchange projections, is projected to be the winner of this entire summer.
Oh, my gosh. By a lot. And in fact, again, I go back to the fact that we all let ourselves down when we let her get Harry Potter for 30 bucks. But yeah, she's projected to be like 40 million ahead, and then it's really you and me fighting for second. And of course, these are all just the HSX projections. If you go to draft.nsfwshow.com/HSX, it's again, this is all put together by Dan Dirks. It automatically updates with the latest Hollywood Stock Exchange expectations. So right now, you're predicted to be second place, Tom, and then I'm predicted to be a narrow third. It's going to be a close
thing. I'm only 28 million behind Sarah right now by projection.
Ain't
so bad.
Yeah, no, I guess so. Yeah, that's not as far as
I just need one of her movies to tank.
I know. Maybe Harry Potter. You know what? I don't think Harry Potter's got the goods. Nobody's really watching those anymore.
You know, you can just get it on BitTorrent.
That's how you know this game's gotten serious is when you start actively asking people to pirate Sarah's movies.
Don't pirate any movies. I'm just kidding. JKLOLRIAAMPAA.
Well, that's good.
All right, yeah, so we already talked about...
I'm glad that we're finally at the point where, you know, the challenge is... Now's when the smack-talking actually begins.
Yeah, I did jokingly on Twitter say that I had bought a ticket for a different movie and sneaked into Thor so I wouldn't help Justin Robert Young. it's getting vicious out there. I watched Thor. We talked about that already. You actually watched a random movie on HBO.
Well, and it's like I cannot remember the last time I've done this. You know, of course, in the spreadsheet we say, what do we watch? I was like, I don't watch any movies. I said, like, wait, I did watch one. After Game of Thrones, we watched it on the DVR, and I went upstairs and live streamed. We did some Portal 2 co-op, And then when I came out, I heard screaming downstairs. I was like, the heck is this? And I went downstairs, and it turned out that Nightmare on Elm Street, the remake, was on HBO. And I ended up getting sucked in. And I can't, I think it might have been like 5 or 6 years since I've ever randomly gotten sucked into a movie. That was a very novel experience for me. The movie was totally unremarkable, though.
Let's move on to Tube Tops. Wear some tube tops. Put them on. Enjoy. Just real quickly, as a follow-up to all of our cable revenue discussions, Cablevision had their earnings at the end of last week. Pretty solid quarter. Revenues were up. Profits were up. Video subscriptions declined. So pretty much the same pattern we saw with Time Warner and Comcast. Nothing really new to say about that. We just wanted to note it in case you were wondering if everybody's feeling that same trend. Another story, Watch ESPN app, now available on Android. Go anywhere live TV streams, but it is restricted based on provider. ESPN does this with their services. It says you have to be on the right ISP.
So, and of course, we're seeing the same thing with the HBO Go app, but I already know, I don't passionately follow any sports, really, but I do know that there are people who are psychotically into this stuff, and if you ask people why they don't cut the cord, why don't you get rid of your cable, the number one answer is almost always sports-related. But so this isn't a case of MLB doing anything. This isn't the NFL.
This is ESPN.
Now, is there restrictions on their programming where it's like, even though you have the channel, it's blacked out?
Okay, here's the thing. If you're a Time Warner Cable, Bright House, or Verizon Fios TV subscriber, then when you get this app, you can stream everything. ESPN, ESPN2, ESPN3, and ESPNU. If you're a Fios Internet subscriber, you can access ESPN3, but that's it. ESPN3 being their online-only version of the service. Everybody else locked out entirely.
So now, does ESPN do, I know that there are certain affiliates that or ESPN can't show certain games in certain areas because they've got agreements with their local.
Yeah, exactly. So you're still under the same restrictions you would be by watching ESPN on your television. So that's why you have to register via Time Warner Cable, Bright House, or Verizon Fios TV, because it's going to say, okay, you're in that zip code. This is the ESPN you're going to get. But you'll get exactly the same ESPN that you would get on your television.
Okay, so but it is going to be customized for you. So like let's say you're in San Francisco.
Well, it's more or less customized than the ESPN you get on cable.
Right. But just so I'm clear on it, let's say you and I go for a drunken bender in Las Vegas, right? You're registered in San Francisco. I'm registered in Austin, Texas. There's some game on. I don't even know who's for where. There's a Giants game on or whatever. And we both pull out our ESPN apps. Slightly different programming, I guess. Because based on
most of the time, no. I mean, honestly, that issue comes up very rarely. Most of the time on Sunday Night Baseball, they secure the rights for everything. Okay. Every once in a while, there'll be something that's available in your local market, and they won't allow you to see it. What I don't know is if you and I are both in Las Vegas, can we still access everything, or is it going to say, oh, you're out of town?
So I got to imagine that they want, because the HBO Go is very explicit. It's like, it's, anything you want, wherever you are, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that what it is?
And this is Watch ESPN. So I'm assuming I can watch ESPN no matter where I am, as long as I got an internet connection.
Yeah. And this is not like the Time Warner app for the iPad where it has to be on your you have to be on your own home's Wi-Fi. You can't be watching, your channels while you're outside of the home.
All right, let's get into what we're watching. And when we do, I want to point out that I have been using a new application both online and on my phone called SideReel. It's actually not a new website. SideReel's been around for a long time, but they have some new services that have been launched, including what I find invaluable, a calendar that you can customize to show only what you're watching.
Wow.
So right now, I look at my calendar. I'm in my profile, and it says, the next show to watch is coming up Thursday, The Office. Friday, Smallville. Saturday, Doctor Who. Sunday, Game of Thrones. Tells me what the shows are and what time they're on.
It's this literal realization of what happens in our minds anyway when we open up the TV guide and we only see the programs we care about. But in this case, you literally only see the programs you care about.
And you can customize it. The other cool thing is it allows you to note which ones you've watched. So if you're catching up on a season, and you've got 7 on the DVR, and you can't remember if you've watched them all, You can use this to find out, okay, did we miss any? Did the DVR not record any? Because it's going to have all the episodes in there, and you can see, okay, I watched those. That description matches that, so I haven't missed any. Okay, I'm going to start there. It's even better if you're going back and catching up on an old series, and you're maybe watching some of them off your DVR and some of them on Netflix, and you got DVDs. You can compile it all together and be like, okay, this is the master list, and every time I watch it, I mark it. I'm fascinated with this app. I think it's brilliant.
That's actually great, because how many times have you run into that situation where you're like, what episode are we on, 5 or 6? And you're like, I think it was 6. And you start it up and it's like, previously on Lost. And then major spoilers in the previouslys. You're like, oh, crap. No, I was on 5.
I did that this weekend. I wanted to catch up on Stargate Universe and Sanctuary. Stargate Universe had its series finale on Monday. I was like, I've got to catch up. I used Side Reel to make sure that I hadn't missed any, and I knew exactly which ones to watch. And awesome. I have to say, so sad to see Stargate Universe go. Final episode was tone perfect in its ending. They knew they were getting canceled, so they did an ending episode, but they wrapped it up in a way that it could be brought back, but they also wrapped it up in a way that it could never be brought back. And that sort of indeterminacy was perfect. You got the sense that, oh my God, the story is ending too soon. Because of circumstances. It was so well done.
Wow. I know they did kind of a similar thing there, the third or fourth to last Firefly episode. It was after they knew that it wasn't looking good for the series. And there's a moment that they have, you know, like some character dies and there's this really sentimental moment. And it's like, that's really the show. That's what The Wake is for.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And then that's what's going on with Stargate Universe, which, wow, did it do a 180. When it started, I liked it well enough because it was Stargate. But, you know, I wasn't thrilled. It just got better and better. By the time they began the second season, I was hooked. And the stories got better throughout the second season. They were brilliant at the end. I thought they did a fantastic job, and I'm so sorry to see it go.
Now, you as somebody who loved the story and loved the experience and was frustrated with the ending, would you recommend somebody go back and watch it all the time? You know, because again, you know, it's the Firefly syndrome where it's just like this little archive of heaven for sci-fi people. You need to watch it from the beginning to the end and you will love every moment of it. But I know that it's got kind of a rocky backstory with the Stargate universe. Should I go watch it or
yeah, no? I mean, you're going to give a lot of trolls the wrong impression by mentioning Firefly and Stargate universe in the same breath. They're not comparable. I'm not saying that. Just because Brian brought up Firefly as an example, don't get the misimpression saying.
Jammer B can roll it back. I think you said it's
no.
Better.
I'm talking about impressions, not what we actually said. I'm combating the people who don't listen closely. So for those people who don't listen closely, very clearly, Stargate Universe is not as good as Firefly. Put down your guns and take off your brown coats. I love Firefly.
You heard it say it. Better than Firefly.
Stargate Universe, on the other hand, very good. I think if you're going to go back and catch up and you can watch several episodes at a go, that you can get through that first season without as much hesitation and weirdness as you had watching it. But you could also maybe skip an episode. I'd watch the first three and then just look at the descriptions for that first half of that first season and maybe skip some if you want. Second half of the first season I would watch. And I would definitely watch the entire second season.
Wow. All right. We'll give it a try. Maybe.
Totally better than Firefly. Sanctuary is back, and I'm a little disappointed. You know, it's in its third season, and third season is usually the magic season for any series. It's usually when it really just gels, and I'm not feeling it. I still like it. I'm still going to watch it, but I'm a little underwhelmed. I kind of wish it was pushing it that far to where I was recommending it to everyone, and I'm not. Fringe finale, wow. All I got to say is go catch up. For God's sake, go catch up before next season.
All I know is at some point, I guess it was on Friday night, but all of a sudden, like, I got hit with an explosion of tweets, like, just anger at me for not having started Fringe. Like, there's something about that that's just like, all right, now Brushwood's just a complete freaking idiot for not having watched Fringe. So now it's got to happen.
Last week's Doctor Who was good. It was okay. You could skip it. It's, you know, pirates and interestingness. It was kind of one of your classic of the reboot Doctor Who, like, niche episodes. If you're really into pirates, you're going to love it. If not, it's missable. This week's Doctor Who coming up, written by Neil Gaiman.
Really?
Neil Gaiman wrote it. So I'm saying, if you want to get into Doctor Who and you don't want to go watch all of the backstory of everything else, watch this weekend.
Okay. Wait, do you know anything about it? Is there a specific reason you're saying that? That was very mysterious.
Well, Neil Gaiman is brilliant, and that's all I need to know.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
Everything he touches turns to gold.
It does. And in fact, actually, you know, one of the things we haven't talked about is the upcoming American Gods project on HBO, right? Are you familiar with
that? Yes. I've heard about that, and I know about the casting call to do the audiobook as well. But we've been talking about it on Sword and Laser, the fact that they're going to possibly do an HBO series on it.
Yeah, you've read American Gods, right?
Yeah, I've read it twice, actually.
Yeah. It seems like it would be another perfect, if Game of Thrones is right for HBO, then I think American Gods definitely could be as well.
Or Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones. That's what they're going to rename it to. It's going to go to Showtime in an effort to steal market share. They're going to call it Game of Thrones.
All right. Game of Thrones. I assume you watched it this weekend as well.
Dude, I'm not going to kid you. First of all, let me say, like, I think on Friday I was sick. And so I was just like, you know what? I'm just going to play. I'm going to go through all the rest of the first season of Boardwalk Empire, watch like 5 or 6 episodes. And by the end of it, I could say I'm fully invested in the story. I know the characters now. The world, I actually like the fact that they don't hit me over the head with the fact that this takes place in the Prohibition area. It feels like a real space to me, a real world. I want questions answered. I want to see where things go now. And I'm like, oh, good, I'm into it. And then 2 days later, I watched Game of Thrones, and I was just like, I don't give a rat's ass about Boardwalk Empire. The moment I wake up Monday morning, I'm sad because it's 6 more days until next Sunday when I get to watch the next Game of Thrones. And it's not because I've already read the books. It is because this is a freaking phenomenal, in-depth, beautiful show with characters that have machinations within machinations, and you can taste the deceit in them. I am deeply in love with Game of Thrones, and it doesn't matter if you've read the book or even heard of the book or if you like fantasy, because there's no fantasy. It's fantasy with no fantasy, and it's awesome.
I think that Game of Thrones is suffering with some people who haven't read the book in all of its setup. I know Eileen has said she's really only interested in Daenerys' story right now. The rest of it, she's kind of bored with. So I told her next week, the story changes. Next week is when everything begins. All of the setup they've been doing, introducing you to the characters, getting you to know who the characters are and the interrelationships, that's prep work. I still find it compelling, and I think most people do. But if it has been dragging for you a little bit, hold on till next week. Because all hell is about to break loose.
Especially this fourth episode was the most heaviest, where they were telling backstory. I mean, there's entire moments where there's a scene when, of course, Littlefinger leans over and says, "Hey, see that guy? Let me take 4 minutes and tell you a backstory about him." You know, it's very dense with backstory and talking about, you know, who is related to whom and stuff. And a lot of it is going to fall off your brain. It's going to roll off like water off a duck's back. And that's kind of how it was reading the book as well. But when you need to remember, you will remember. That's all I'm going to say about that.
And winter is coming. All right. Yes. Quick break to thank our other sponsor, Netflix.com. Of course, you can get DVD movies in about a day, but also streaming thousands of titles right to your PC, your Mac, your Xbox 360, your Nintendo Wii, right there on your television. You can watch all the kind of movies. We talk about it all the time. And you can get a 30-day free trial right now at netflix.com/twit. If you had to recommend, Brian Brushwood, one movie that would compel someone to try out Netflix for 30 days for free in order to support Framerate at netflix.com/twit, what movie would that be?
You know what? I'm not even going to limit to one movie, because there's so many good movies that I'm going to say, if we played Mad Libs right now, dangerously, give me a noun, an adjective, and a exclamation. Quick. A noun.
A noun?
Yeah.
Ball.
Bald. Ball. There you go. Ball. All right. Now give me an adjective.
Rough.
Rough. And you know what? I'll just do ball and rough. We'll see what we get. And we got Christian Bale movies. We got
he's a rough ball, right?
Roughness, the movie about football. We got Rough Magic. We got Monsters Ball. We got Rough Riders. Smokin' Aces 2 is available on instant streaming here. We got Ballistic, X versus Sever. Look, I'm telling you, you can't go wrong. And the best part is, do you know what the best part about Netflix is? It's not the fact that you can get DVDs in one business day. It's not the fact that they have thousands of titles of TV and movies available for instant streaming on a variety of devices, including your Nintendo Wii, your Xbox 360, or your PS3. It's the fact that it can read your mind. Nobody talks about the Netflix recommendation algorithm, where you tell it what movies you like, you rate them on a scale of 1 to 5 stars, and it can figure out what you're going to love or hate. And in fact, you'll notice that when you look at a movie, it'll say on there, our guest for you. It'll say, like, our best guest for Brian, 2.2 stars. Now, and it'll say what everyone else likes is, most people, it's 2.9 stars. And sure enough, man, that's the game. Watch one of these movies and then give a rating, and you'll see that, boom, they get it right every freaking time. Netflix is mind-reading powers.
Try it out. 30 days free. Netflix.com/twit. Let's move on to Interferon. Mortal Kombat Legacy web series? What the hell is this?
I know, right? This was one that came in from the email. I got like 3 emails from people bringing up like, oh, you got to talk about Mortal Kombat Legacy. And I was like, oh, of course I do. I also need to talk about, the Tetris, the movie. And then at some point, then one person wrote in and said, I could care less about the video game. I could care less about the terrible movies from the 90s and the early 2000s. But this is really something special. And the story goes that this guy had put together, I'm going to go see if I can cue it up here. Maybe Jammer B can get it on his end. But the story goes that the guy had put together, he'd spent thousands of dollars producing this and had intended to pitch the idea of a reboot of the Mortal Kombat franchise as a TV series. And this is the part that I don't know if it's true or not, but allegedly he uploaded it to YouTube intending for it to be a private video or an unlisted video, but instead went public and generated a bunch of buzz because everybody thought they were seeing leaked footage from a new Mortal Kombat movie. And we're talking about, like, I glanced around through this thing. The quality of the production is fantastic, and you see Hilo from Battlestar Galactica's in there, and a number of other...
Jerry Ryan, 7 of 9, seems to be in there.
Yeah, and it really looks good. I'm just going to grab a random scene. I don't know if this is going to end up being something that really shows it off well or not. But I think this is...
But he has got a deal to do webisodes, right?
Well, that's just it. Is they pitched the show, and they said, you know what? We're not going to do a show, but we love what you're doing here, and it's amazing that you're able to do it on a budget. Why don't you keep doing it? So he's making it as a series of webisodes, and I think this scene here, you got Sonya is spying on these guys while she's getting ready to... And they're very clear that this is all TVMA. They're like, this is not for all audiences here. But the production quality is like anything you'd see on television.
Dragon's Warehouse, 20 of them wash.
Hey, look, 7 of 9.
Weapons to be shipped out tomorrow under code name Cyber Initiative. I think this is what we've been looking for.
It's cool. Okay, I'm going to jump. I'm going to see if I can jump ahead here and see some of the other scenes here. But is this something you watch? Is there a stigma about webisodes that would keep you from watching this, Tom?
You know, there's not a stigma about it. The reason I don't watch webisodes more often is I'm not in a situation where it's easy. I have to remember that it exists. Then I have to remember where it exists. Then I have to have the motivation to go to that place if it exists on the device that I'm using. You know, I mean, it's... Theoretically, yeah, I can watch a YouTube video on my television through lots of ways, through the Roku, through Google TV, through hooking up a computer, but it's not I don't have a habit built up for that, and it's not super simple.
Yeah, this is kind of the weird, we talk all the time about the kind of the top-down perspective of high-end content filtering out into the web, but I love seeing the reverse, man. I love seeing people with cool ideas and a passion for what they want to do, taking, especially, you know, let's face it, the Mortal Kombat movie franchise is not exactly, A-list material. It's not super valuable property, so they can afford to take a risk and do something nutty and just let somebody run around and make episodes for, you know, for all we know. Like, you know, $3,000 and a donut per episode.
Also, JerrySeinfeld.com is becoming a home for all of Jerry Seinfeld's video. In fact, saying that, you know what? Why would I go to pitch to an executive producer a TV show and get feedback from them when I can just put some video up on my own website and get feedback from the audience, whether it's something they like?
Yeah, think about this. This is a case where I'm looking forward to seeing this develop because this is essentially doing on purpose what crowdsources will do on their own anyway. I mean, you could right now probably find, you know, bazillions of different Jerry Seinfeld performances from, you know, all over his career. He's got all those in his garage. And he's like, well, let's do this on purpose. And so he's releasing a complete archive of every recorded performance he's given. And I don't know what the story is going to be as far as licensing rights for a lot of that stuff. But my guess is when you're Jerry freaking Seinfeld, you can clear up those licensing issues pretty easily. But I love this, that you can go into his entire public life. I mean, every performance he's ever given, and watch him at his first, you know, TV performance and see how he shapes his comedy over time. This is a really neat idea. And somebody who loves the craft of comedy as much as Jerry Seinfeld did. Did you ever see his movie Comedian?
No, I never did.
Yeah, it was really good. It's actually, he's very upfront. You see the development of his act, where of a brand new act, where he wants to do a whole new hour-long stand-up show. So you see him walk up on stage in this, you know, nothing comedy club, because comedians could do that. You can just walk in and say, hey, I'm Jerry Seinfeld, let me up there. And then you see him half-heartedly reading these jokes from cards, and you see him shape and hone everything over time. So for somebody who's comfortable exposing the development of himself as a comedian over time, I'm really interested to see what he puts together on this website.
All right, let's move on to feedback. Because now it's time for feedback with Brian and Tom on Right, oh yeah.
It always pauses there. I don't know why.
It's because of that picture of you. It's just,
I know.
The computer gets fixated on your visage.
It pops in, and I'm just like,
oh, who is you? That? Who is that fetching-looking fellow?
Exactly.
All right, we're running pretty long here. Should we just pick one a piece to read?
Yes, absolutely.
All right, you go first because you're familiar with them. I'm going to scan.
Okay, no, actually, I got a number of people hitting me hard on the fact that I was not familiar with Lock and Key. So this one, Keith Keetover says to me, you mentioned Lock and Key in the last show, and it was obvious that you haven't read it. Do yourselves a favor and read them. Great stuff. There are three volumes with the fourth on the way.
Ooh,
duly
nice.
Noted, sir.
All right, good to know. Mark says, hey, Framerate, love the great discussion. Sometimes want to hug you. Sometimes want to throw my iPod at you. But that's a good thing, right?
Yes.
I think so, as long as those are in fairly equal measure. Without getting all techie, I just want to let you know that in Canada, national ratings and audience measurement is done via a portable meter like a pager called a PPM. It works by detecting an inaudible code embedded by the broadcaster in the audio track of the video, so it detects viewing anywhere the person is as long as it can pick up the code, which is then cross-referenced to determine the program being watched. This technology has the ability to measure video from any platform as long as the code is embedded by the broadcaster. Someday, I believe the industry in Canada will migrate to this multi-device viewing measurement model. We just need to change everyone's mindset and budgets. We have a people meter here as well. It's used for some of Nielsen and Arbitron's types of ratings. It's kind of controversial. The industry's fought back against it for various reasons of accuracy and whether it really works and all of that sort of thing. But yeah, I think that would be the ultimate. I think Mark's exactly right. That would be the ultimate way for this to work.
I've got one quick thing I want to throw in here before we wrap things up. Charlie at Cosmic Vibes sent this in to me. He found an interesting article in the Radio Times, a very popular TV guide over in Blighty. I don't know where Blighty is.
England.
I don't know if that's England, right?
Old Blighty.
This appears in the TV guide there. See if you can spot it.
You know, it took me a while. I, even though he said second line down, first word, I went down to ridden, thinking like, oh, it's the second line down after that. And then finally it hit me. Oh, wait, The Walking Dead is a documentary?
You know what? That's I think that's a testament to the storytelling when you actually have TV Guide believing it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it is, in fact, a documentary.
It is. It's a documentary of a bunch of actors who pretend that zombies are attacking
them. That's right.
If you want to send us your thoughts, send them over to frameratedshow@gmail.com. We do read all of them, and in fact, I'm able to send off a brief response to most of them, but we love to keep them short and to the point. We'll get them on the show, and I guess that's it for this episode of Frame Rate.
Yeah, thanks everybody for watching. Go to twit.tv/FR to find the rest of our episodes if you would like to do so. Until next week with Sarah and Brian, I'll see you in 2 weeks. They'll see you next week.